So basically, under the National Water Act, they have passed. They have actually allocated water for basic human needs, that is drinking water primarily. And then they said, okay, water is for the ecological reserve, which will mean the environmental flows assessment. And after that, if at all there is spare water, then you can go for infrastructure and other developmental activities. So that's one addition. And I mean, I had a opportunity to talk to some of the people who were closely associated with the formulation of that act, so that's how I could know that. Okay, now building block methodology. This methodology has been so much talked about, but when we started this ecological assessment in 2007, there was no dialogue around holistic methodologies for assessment of environmental flows. Water Quality Assessment Authority and other informal initiatives talk more about the hydrological models, hydrology-based modeling exercises, which leads to environmental flows, but doesn't take into account of the holistic picture or a comprehensive picture. So here I concentrate more on the building block methodology and how it has evolved over the time and how we have adopted it for the Upper Ganga Basin under the Living Ganga program. So it's one of the most comprehensive methodology falling under the set of holistic methodologies for assessment of environmental flows. It's a bottom-up approach and it's much more detailed. There is about 500 pages detailed manual which describes each and every step of the building block methodology in fairly detailed manner so that one can easily adopt it or go through it and do the assessment for their respective river basin. It's mostly, most frequently used holistic methodology around the world, largely in North America and in Africa, South Africa. It's, as I said, it's a very well documented methodology. One of the key aspects of this methodology is that it gives you an opportunity to integrate your local aspects into the process itself for doing the assessment of e-flows. Like in case of Ganga, the cultural and spiritual aspects are of immense importance. So this methodology provides you the room to integrate those aspects into the assessment of e-flows so that when you come out with the recommended flows, you have those aspects embedded into it. And it works in both the scenarios. If it's a very data-rich scenario, that's also fine. If it's not very rich in terms of data availability, then also you can still come out with reasonably confident environmental flows. And it gives you an opportunity to link with the external stakeholders, the larger people, the communities, and then narrows down to some selected experts who were working in the river on the associated aspects from years. Well, it is a bit resource intensive methodology because it takes about 1.5 to 2 years minimum to do the assessment. So, I mean, we have seen some of the examples where BVM has been done in about 2 or 3 months. So, I'm not sure what sort of BVM approach they have adopted. So, it's essentially four-step methodology in which we interact with the stakeholders and try to set the objective for the river. That what should be the environmental or ecological objective for the river. Now, this is a crucial step. This is where everything flows from this. I mean, if we set the objective like D or C, then you are going to get a very low environmental flow value. So this is something which is to be done very carefully, keeping in view the real situation at the ground and talking to the people who are dependent on the river, as well as or take care of the aquatic ecology which is dependent on the river. And then assess a modified flow that will meet those objectives. So if you have set a reasonably good objective, which is practically possible also, then the modified flow regime should be able to meet that. And then use some flow-dependent indicators. It may be dolphins, gharials, turtles, fish invertebrates, and then velocity, depth, river width, and substrate type, which is required for the aquatic biodiversity as well as for the aquatic vegetation. And then identify critical components of flow regime that will govern the environmental condition for all the 3 seasons, that is dry, wet, and monsoon. So it's a fairly long process actually. It starts with a scoping, then it enters to a constitution of the assessment team. Well, it's a fairly comprehensive process which cannot be done by 1, 2, or 3 people. It has to be a team of experts looking into various aspects, into various disciplines like biodiversity, the social aspects, the cultural aspects, the geomorphological aspects, the water quality aspects, and so on. So constitution of a team who will undertake the assessment of inflows itself is a big task. You have to be very careful in identifying what partners should I associate with for this exercise, because they are the ones who will actually lead you to the assessed environmental flows. So a lot will depend upon their competence. Then we conduct a homogeneous zonation study in which we basically zone the river in various homogeneous zones depending upon elevation and other things, other geographic and physical characteristics. And then we do the site selection under each of the zone. That selected site should be fairly representative of the zone. And then we conduct surveys. For River Ganga, which has been, facing human intervention since 1850, so you don't have the data of that time, that what the river was prior 1850. So you do, you try to find out a stretch or a point throughout the river which will be fairly representative of a reference zone or a site according to all the experts' perspective. And then you set the present ecological status, that okay, reference condition is this. Now we have, let's say we have six zones, so in all the six zones the current ecological state is D, E, C, whatever. And then you set, and then you define the environmental objectives. The one which we said in the beginning, that we have to set environmental objectives very carefully, which class the river should be. So now from the present ecological state, we have to reach to the level that this should be the objective, and that is where the environmental flow recommendations will add to, and that is where the e-flows will lead to reach the objectives which you set. And then you reach to stage C, where environmental flow assessment setting workshop happens. It's generally a 5 to 6 days affair, and in which all the partners, all the teams who were associated in doing all the surveys and all the sub-studies under this larger study participate and negotiate on hydrological yield analysis. They basically come out with their recommendations, their specific recommendations for flows for particular sites, and then that leads to final decision through brainstorming within the teams, that okay, if somebody wants X quantum of water for biodiversity, then that is that okay for other teams to be, like for hydrology for geomorphology or for water quality, the kind of water required by biodiversity, is it okay by them? Is it going to sustain their functions as well in the river? If not, then there is a deliberation, then there is a discussion, and a consensus is reached, and that is what environmental flows is. But that's one stage which is not so challenging. The real challenge comes when it reaches to the implementation stage and then to the compliance monitoring, which so far we have reached to this stage, at least in our exercise, but we have not even entered that. So key challenge lies in implementation, but the important thing is that this implementation will flow from the kind of objectives you have set. If you have set the objectives very low, then it is not acceptable within the community, within the stakeholders. Forget about the implementation then, if people are not agreeing. So for us, the objective was to promote sustainable water resources in Ganga River Basin, which should ensure ecological integrity, provide livelihood, and maintain sacred values of the river. As in one of the slides which Suresh presented, that we have concentrated in the upper stretch of Ganga, which is from Gangotri to Kanpur, and that was the area where we have done the assessment of inflows also. For us, the flow indicators were fish, dolphins, invertebrates, algae, religious rites, and various river channel processes, morphological processes. For that we required habitat information, various activities and processes knowledge. And with that we also came up with the depth, velocity and width and substrate requirement for basic functions, which finally lead us to cubic meter per second of water required by all the experts and the team. The first stage is you set up the team, then you zone the river. So what we did, we actually come out with 7 zones from Gangotri to Kanpur, but we narrowed it down to 4 zones because it was discussed that these 4 zones are fairly representative. So upper zone represents Gangotri to Rishikesh, the reference zone which we considered was upstream of Brahmaputra to Narora, and in this reference zone there is a site which is upstream of Narora barrage. Where by virtue of having barrage over there and Narora atomic power plant where water supply is definite and is required by the plant, so there is enough water over there, so your biodiversity is happy over there and they are proliferating over there. And the third zone for us was Middle East, which is Narora to Farukhabad, and zone 4 was the Lower East from Kannauj to Kanpur. There were 6 components under that study. The hydrology component consists of these activities. They identified and reviewed previous hydrological modeling studies and assessment of their usability in current conditions and for the current study. They have to set up a model and calibrate under existing conditions of land and water use within the basin. They have to examine the feasibility of different ways of modeling the past natural and present flows using observed flow data. Now this observed flow data is something we struggled with throughout our study because we could not get access to real-time flow data. We did get some data, but not in the manner like, not in the time series manner. We could get it in monthly duration or so. Then the second component is fluvial geomorphology and hydraulic modeling, in which we basically analyze the sediments in the river, the assessments of their effect, and which will the assessment of the effect, and that will lead to various regimes in the flows, like what are their requirements. And analyze the channel and floodplain morphology in terms of geomorphic features and their sediment. And later on, the hydraulics group generated the cross sections and longitudinal profile for hydraulic modeling, because this is something which was used later during the ECLOS assessment workshop by various experts to come out with the recommended flows. The biodiversity group looked into present condition in terms of difference between the reference condition and survey results. I mean, they have all the teams has done surveys for one complete year to take care of all the seasons falling within 1 year. So, I mean, it's a sort of prerequisite that if BPM is less than 1.5 to 2 years, then whether it is BPM or not, that itself can be there. Here we are so attached spiritually or culturally to the river, so this has to be integrated within the methodology. But it was challenging for the team. I'm sure Dr. Ravi Chopra knows how they have done it because they were the partners for us. So representation of river in mythology, folklore, folk art and popular literature, they have basically reviewed the literature, the old historical manuscripts where they could find the significance of values of Ganga and how that is associated with people and how people look at it and how our religious books talks about Ganga, what value they give to Ganga. Then they conducted interviews and focus group discussions with various people living on the banks of the river as well as those tourists who visit those places to find out what are their aspirations from the river as well as what they have seen, what deterioration they have observed in the recent past. The sixth was the water quality and pollution group. They basically first they basically reviewed the existing available water quality data, and they identified that in addition to this, so and so data is also required. So they identified 30 stations in that 800 kilometer stretch and did water quality sampling by grab samples on those 30 locations. And they also assessed impact of the pollutants onto the river and how e-flows can help that. They also tried to do assessment of that.
So this is a typical cross section of Kachla Ghat. Just to show you that hydraulics group came out with these cross sections for each of the site, and they actually did three cross sections for each of the site. One is at the upstream, one is at the lower stream, and one is at the central point. Step 2 was basically flow motivations. These are the motivations which comes from people, so far as cultural, spiritual and livelihood group is concerned. They had interacted with people, they try to understand from them what are their aspirations, what are their needs from the river and how they want their river to look like. All the teams filled this flow motivation form during the environmental flows assessment, environmental flow setting workshop, which we held in Rishikesh in May 2019. In order to
come out with recommended e-clause, the term maintenance clause is very important, because what we recommend is actually maintenance clause. Maintenance clause are the normal years, not very wet, not very dry, and they are the years when you have all the ecological functioning functions happening in the proper manner. For us, based on our data or whatever global data sets we have, we came to the conclusion that over 100 years of time, 70 years should be the maintenance years, and 30 years could be between maintenance and the drought year. That means for a long term inflows, water volume required will be at maintenance recommendations for higher or more than 70% of time. We later on compiled all the recommendations and recommended flows made by the experts and expert teams. So just a glimpse of one such table where you can see the critical flow for Cordillera site for January maintenance. Actually, we identified January as the driest month and August as the wettest month. So what we did, we came out with the recommended flows for driest month as well as for wettest month, and then we do the interpolation to derive a yearly requirement of recommended flows. Okay, so the biodiversity group for the January maintenance recommended this flows, and then they provided the motivation that this is why we are recommending this flow, this is why we need this flows. Then we come to fluvial geomorphology group. In the same season, for the same site, they recommended this flow, and they have these motivations, that because of these motivations, we want these flows. Now, the flow varies actually. The first group asked for 265 cumen, the second group asked for 400 cumen. Similarly, other three groups also came out with different figures. Then there was a deliberation within the larger team. Okay, what is acceptable for everyone? And that's a crucial point, because we may get carried away by saying that okay, I want 1000 cumen for this season. But is it hydrologically possible? Is it, given the set of constraints we have, possible? So that is what the role of the facilitator. We were fortunate enough to have Professor Jayoki to play that role for us, along with the EME doing the hydrology exercise for us. So they were actually doing the reality check on the kind of flow recommendations each of the group was giving. It basically shows that what influenced our recommended flows at various sites. If you look at Cordillera, the January maintenance flows was influenced by fluvial geomorphology group. I mean, the group gave the recommendations, and their recommendations were agreed by other groups that okay, this will also sustain our functions. So this is the key flows for us for this site for this season. For August maintenance flow, biodiversity group actually came out with the recommendation, and that is what discussed, debated and agreed to by other groups that okay, this is what we also feel that should be the environmental flow for this site and for this season. Similarly, for Kachla Ghat and Mittur, the August flows, the monsoon flows is driven by cultural and spiritual requirements. Suresh has already mentioned about that Brahma temple thing, and it basically got driven from that, because that's the aspiration, that's the requirement, that's the clear indication that this is what we want. So that's how it comes here. Almost half of the critical flow recommendations were influenced by a biodiversity component. I mean, throughout our exercise, that is for three sites, for two seasons for each of the sites, more than half of the recommendations were influenced by biodiversity requirements. Calculating annual environmental flow requirements. Driest and wettest month under maintenance and drought conditions. As I said earlier, we identified January as the driest month and August as the wettest month. And this is based on the data we had for the stage. E-flow values were calculated based on the inputs. I think this is what I have explained already. And monthly flow volume for each month of the year for low flow and high flow component were calculated. Now, arriving at E-flows, it's an example from Kachla Ghat. You see two lines here. Now, this blue line shows August maintenance requirement for a normal year. And the red line shows August requirement for a drought year. Like, if you have less than 30% of 100% of years, then this should be the E-flows for this particular site. Whereas, in a usual year, which is a maintenance year, the E-flow requirement should be this. Now, come to the dry season. The normal year requirement is this, and in a drought year, this. Now, one can ask that why such a variation? you have to understand that in a drought year, you need to make sure that the very basic functions, either of the biodiversity or of the geomorphology or of the cultural and spiritual aspects, should be maintained. So in order to maintain those functions, these recommendations are made. One cannot be over-ambitious here, because we know that drought is a condition where you don't have that much flow. So one has to be very, very realistic in this. So these are the results for us for zone 1, which is from Gangotri to Rishikesh. 72% of mean annual runoff is what we come out with as environmental flows. We could not get the data from Tehri dam downstream, so that's why we could not plot the present day flows for this site. But we have the present day flow for rest of the sites. So here, these are the natural flows which could happen if there is no intervention, if there is no dam or barrage. And then this is what is required. In the Kachla Ghat, where 45% of mean annual runoff is recommended for maintenance here. And this line shows the present day flows. And you can see that present day flow doesn't meet the flows requirement except for the monsoon stream.
So which we couldn't compare for the first site?
Yeah, we couldn't do that for the first site because we don't have the present day flow for that. For the third site, again you can see that the present day flow fails to achieve actually the e-flow requirement for most of the months. We did this exercise and it was sort of preliminary, or I would say an exercise which was never conducted earlier for river basin like Ganga, and there was several shortfalls also. And we know that now, at least we know that these are the issues. If we address these, we can come up with more confident recommended flows. So the key one is access to observed long-term hydrological data is critical to do the assessment of these flows. Without that, one cannot be 100% confident that this is what I want for the river. Because you need to have that present day flow in the manner the methodology requires. Then further calibration and verification of existing rate cross sections is needed. The cross sections which we did not take into account the floodplains, which the team concluded at the end that it's important to include the floodplains also. So ideally, for e-flows assessment exercise, one should also cover the floodplains while doing the cross sections. And the this was the first exercise. All the experts were champions in their subjects, but relating that to environmental flows was a challenge for all of us. That is why it's important to understand or to further do the research on relationship between indicator species, official invertebrates, and flows that would allow more precise flow recommendations. Water quality, more precise relationship between water quality parameters and flows would have allowed predictions in a much more better way. Once again, just to reiterate that e-flows is not a one-time flow, it's a regime of flows throughout various seasons. Assess e-flows using a holistic methodology, because that is what will bring the acceptability plus people's support to that. It has to be an integral part of environmental impact assessment and cumulative impact assessment. We have glimpsed through both the reports which are in public domain, but one doesn't take account of holistic methodology, other take account of holistic methodologies but not in the right spirit. So where we are, and this needs to be placed in the context of river basin management in a larger manner, a holistic manner. To me, environmental flows is just one subset of integrated water resources management. And e-flows assessment is an adaptive process. I mean, when we started, there are whole set of methodologies under holistic methodology also. But we selected BBM. Maybe 10 years down the line, somebody come up with a more better or improvised version of BBM or a different methodology, which is fine. It's an adaptive process.